Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 to 8. Hallelujah. I won't go down the road and say, this is the country we live in, blah, 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 and all of that, but it's well. We all have enough stress each day, but I trust God that we will always push through, that the devil will not have his way. All that happened is just distractions. You know, just distraction, you know, emergency. And as my pastor's wife, I look at my WhatsApp, please, ma, pray for me. Ma, I need to see you. And I'm saying, I'm preparing message to go. It is well. So I'm sure many of us can relate with it. But push through in Jesus' name. Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 to 8. Are we there? Let's have it on the screen. Then the word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you and ordained you a prophet to the nations. Then said I, ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a youth. But the Lord said to me, do not say I am a youth, for you shall go to all whom I shall send you, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of their faces, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. God uses his words to communicate his plans to us. God uses words to express what we are about. God was trying to tell Jeremiah here what he wanted him to do or be. He said, I've ordained you a prophet to the nations. And to make it really strong, he told Jeremiah that I didn't just think about this now. I didn't just decide overnight. You know, I didn't just wake up and think, oh yes, let me make Jeremiah a prophet. He said, before you were formed in your mother's womb. So he was trying to communicate to Jeremiah that it's not about what you are doing now. It's not about God looks at you and says, oh, I think he can do this. I think he can be a businessman. I think she can be a preacher. No, he said that was already factored in so that Jeremiah would have that picture in his mind that I was born for this. And then Jeremiah said, ah, does that sound familiar? Ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I'm a youth. As if God didn't know. As if God didn't know he was a youth. As if God didn't know that he stammered. And then God said to him, don't say I'm a youth. Don't say I'm incapable. Don't describe yourself by how you are now or your physical qualifications. He said, don't say I'm a youth. Yes, he was a youth, right? But he said, don't say I'm a youth. Say what? Say what? I'm a prophet to the nations. Hello? Don't say, ah, but I'm a woman. Say what? I'm a preacher. I'm an apostle to the nations with signs following. Amen. What are you saying about yourself? I'm just a woman. You know, they really don't find women there. God knows that already. But he said, stop saying, stop describing yourself by your physical composition. Describe yourself by who I have called you, by the spiritual. And God said, you are a prophet to the nations. So this is Jeremiah reporting himself. After all, he wrote this book. He said, so I said, and God said, don't say I'm a youth, for you shall go to all whom I send you, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of their faces, for I'm with you to deliver you, says the Lord. And God said, do not be afraid, because many times, it's because of fear that we do not accept what he has said. Because of fear, we do not accept what he has said. Because we are looking at what people will say if we declare this thing. Because they're already judging us. Hello? You may not have any money in your pocket today, but you see yourself as a wealthy person. Declare what you are seeing. Hello? Don't declare what people are seeing. Don't be afraid that people will make fun of you and say, ah, see the person calling herself wealthy. See him calling someone wealthy. He could not even, you know, buy himself some food yesterday or whatever. But you know what you are seeing and you know what you believe and you know what God has said to you. So you have to continue to see and you have to continue to speak. So God uses words to communicate his plans to us. Because when he speaks his word, You don't just see the words. What do you see? A picture. If I say cat, what do you see? In your mind, what do you see? A black cat or a white cat? Maybe your neighbor has a black cat. Maybe when you are growing up, you had a cat in your house. So you immediately see that cat or your neighbor's cat. Or if you've never seen a cat before, you see the one that you saw in the storybooks. But I can assure you, you do not see C-A-T, right? Yes. If I say dog, do you see, does D-O-G, the spelling, appear in your mind? You see a dog. So someone sees a bulldog, Alsatian, whatever, but you see a dog or what you think a dog looks like. Hello? So God uses his words to communicate to us. And what did Jeremiah see about himself? This conversation is very interesting because Jeremiah heard the words, but he didn't see accurately. Those words did not displace the picture of himself in his mind. God was speaking to him, trying to form a new picture, trying to give him a paradigm shift, trying to make him see differently, but Jeremiah was still seeing himself as a youth. He was still seeing himself as he was. And God said, you are a prophet to the nation. He said, no, I'm a youth. So you can see that there was a struggle for him to accept the word of God. There's nothing wrong with the word of God. The word of God is powerful. The word of God is life transforming. It's the power of God unto salvation. It gets people saved. Praise God. It transforms life. But when people do not receive it, there's somewhere in the Bible say that you through your traditions have made the word of, God of non-effect in your own life through your tradition. Not that the word is not powerful, but in your own life you made it of non-effect because the picture of tradition, you have held that strong. You have held that strong. So maybe God is showing you someone. You are close to someone from another tribe, but in your mind, you have held it strong that you must marry someone from your tribe, from your village, in fact, from the compound that is next to the family compound. Does that guarantee success in marriage? But people hold on to that because most likely they have seen some examples. That auntie that went to marry Jebodo, you are Benin people. We know what happened to that marriage. All those things, they are physical things. Who do you want to believe? What do you want to see? Do you want to keep seeing that auntie whose marriage did not succeed? And then you think your own marriage will not succeed? And I believe God. I believe God even with singles here. Singleness is not a curse. Hello? It's even a blessing. Some people couldn't say that conveniently. It is a blessing because you have the ability to go to heaven straight when you die. Because you will not be judged by how did you treat your spouse. We that are married, we have to be careful because they will ask us about that matter. Hello? So you that are saying, if you like, treat yourself anyhow. The bee is your life. But if you are married, they will ask you. He used to do this. And God will not say, but didn't I say, you know, submit and respect him. So a man who is married to say, but she was very disrespectful. We said, didn't I say love her? But as single, your own business is just to please the Lord. But the Bible says that if you are married, you have to please God and please your spouse. How do you manage it? Wisdom. Amen. I'm not making a case for you to remain single as Paul did. But I'm just saying that if you want to, it's okay. And if you don't ever get married, it's okay. But don't be the limitation of your not getting married. Don't be the limitation because they're examples of. And let me tell you, this thing about the mindset and what we see is very strong. It's very strong. This is not a boastful thing or anything, but I was thinking recently that, okay, it did not cross my mind that I would not marry. So it doesn't mean that I had all the faith or, I look back now, it's not that I had, you know, someone says, how did you get reverence? I don't know. Yeah, it's not, I didn't have all the faith, but I just knew that, I'll get married. So all the singles here, men, ladies, and men that are here and of marriageable age, can you confidently say you know that you'll get married? I'm not saying you should say after me. Can you say, can you confidently say, oh, there is a struggle? Maybe it will happen, maybe it will not. 38 now, maybe. If you have that struggle, resolve it with God. Get the scriptures. Bible says none shall lack their mate. Hang around people who are married and who are happily married. Because maybe you didn't have that role model. Because I just look at it, it's not to indict anybody, but it's just part of how revelation comes into your heart. What you see constantly, you become. It's just there. And then afterwards, you find out that you didn't struggle about it. Hello? Same thing with the fruit of the womb. Because early in my marriage, I had a miscarriage. I wanted to fail. I wanted to doubt. You know? In fact, I cried a few times. I'm ashamed to say that. Because it was not needed. I didn't have to. But because it was not a long delay. But I didn't hear that people have miscarriages. I didn't hear that you can get pregnant and 8 weeks, the baby's gone. You're bleeding. So I was wondering, what is this? And that was when the fear set in. But I thank God I was able to deal with it, you know, with the word of God. And I look at it today and I tell people that if you are married, and you desire children, it's there. You God ordained that you should be fruitful. You will have children. Don't doubt it. And don't be afraid. Praise God. And if you feel like adopting, adopt. Because adopting is not a sign of it's over and you don't have any more faith. It's a sign of love and compassion. It's a sign of while you are waiting, you have all this love to give. And you can give to a child that is not from your womb. And you'll be amazed at how bonded that child will be. That the child is from your womb doesn't mean that you will love that child throughout. The Bible says in Titus 2 that the older women should teach the younger women how to love their husbands and how to love their children. Because sometimes some children, they can drive you up the wall. You will wonder. And you say, Lord, give me love for this child. As the child begins to grow, and if the child begins to show some traits that is going in a certain direction, there are days when you feel, God, I want to squeeze this child's neck. So we need God's strength. We need God's grace to love. So what I was trying to say was that I just had this revelation in my head. I just had this understanding that I was giving birth to. Someone gave birth to me, right? I'll give birth to my own. Do you get it? So why should there be a pattern that is not there? That one seems even easier to deal with than if you're from a broken home and you're not married and you need to deal with it because you don't know, maybe unconsciously it's affected you. There's healing in Jesus' name. Amen. But just look at it. You're trusting God for the fruit of the womb. You are giving birth to, right? Your mother gave birth to you. Even if you don't know your mother, even if you were adopted, you didn't just drop from the sky. And so you too will give birth to someone. Praise God. So you have to have that picture in your mind that as a man, you will replicate yourself. As a woman, you will replicate yourself. It's a matter of time, but you have to keep the picture in your mind. Praise God. You have to. And once you get the picture, hold on to it. Once you get revelation, once you see, I tell you, it's a matter of time. It doesn't mean that doubts won't come concerning what you are trusting God for. It does. Some people think that when doubt comes into their heart, it has canceled the picture. No. You have to see, look at the word enough. Look at what our pastor always tells us, cut the picture of what looks like what you want. Put it on the wall. It is true what he's saying. We did it from, very early in our marriage. We did it. We just cut, put on the wall. We'll even sometimes forget it there. And then when it happens, we now realize that, isn't this the exact same thing? So, see what God says about you. See what is right. Don't see the negative. Seeing is very important. And seeing comes with words. And that's why we have to read the word of God. Because God's word forms pictures in our hearts. He communicates to us through his words. So, Jeremiah heard these words. They didn't display the picture in his mind. What do you see of yourself? If what you are seeing is not accurate, if it's not right, if it's not what you want, if you know it's not God's plan for you, get into God's word and get a revelation. so that you can see a different you. And that's the picture that you will hold, and that is what will come to pass eventually. So, when you doubt or when you are shaken along the way, it will not displace that picture. It will not stop that picture that you have in your mind from manifesting. The negative, the snapshot has been taken already. It's a matter of time. That's what will be printed out for you in life. Don't be discouraged by doubt. But don't dwell on doubt to the point where that now, you know, the doubt now becomes the major thing and displaces the picture in your mind. You know, the Bible says concerning Abraham in Romans chapter 4, he said he was strong in faith, giving glory to God, right? And he still gave birth to Isaac through Sarah. But is it that he did not doubt at all? He did. You said he did not doubt. He doubted. He doubted. Someone said, Father Abraham, Jim, he doubted. But it still came to pass because he had received that revelation. It was God's purpose for him, and he had already received it, though there were doubts along the way. I think what he doubted was maybe how it will come to pass. How? Because God showed him the stars. You will have this. How it will come to pass. You know, so he decided to help God. Because he said, God, don't even bother anymore. Let this Eliezer in my house, let me just adopt his children as my, you know, don't bother. As if God said he was stressed and he couldn't do it. But God said, I'm still coming through for you. Praise God. And so he gave in to that plan that brought forth Ishmael. And we know what we have in the world today. You will not be derailed in the name of Jesus. Your mistake will not be something that will cost the whole world, you know, and people to be in pain in the name of Jesus. So Jeremiah, in Jeremiah chapter 11, chapter 1, verses 11 to 12. Let's continue the story. Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 11 to 12. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me saying, Jeremiah, what do you see? And I said, I see the branch of an almond tree. The branch of an almond tree in Israel signified the miraculous. It signified fruitfulness. It signified possibilities. Because there was a time, all the 12 tribes, they had to bring out all their rods, you know, the heads of each family or every tribe had to bring their rods. And Aaron brought his rod, they put it in the temple. And because that was the instruction that God gave them. And those people had been speaking against Aaron, they had been saying all kinds of things, but by the next morning, Aaron's rod had budded. You know, there were flowers, there were fruits on it, a dry rod, dry stick. We're talking about the rod of their family, like a walking stick. Very dry stick. And Aaron's rod budded. So that became very significant. So when you see an almond tree in your dream, like he saw an almond tree, and God said, you have seen well. Tell your neighbor, see well. See well. He said, you have seen well. God said, you have seen well, for I am ready to perform my word. I will hasten my word. Another translation says, King James, I will hasten my word to perform it. I am ready to perform my word. That means that God was depending on his seeing through before he could get a breakthrough. He had to see. God, all he was trying to get him to the point that if this guy can see, if Jerry can see what I'm seeing, then it's a matter of time it will come to pass. But I can't be working against, we can't be working against each other. I need his cooperation. God was trying to say, God needs your cooperation. He's God, he's mighty, yes, and he's the God of the miracles. And many times things happen without us having to do anything. But I tell you, if it's by the word, it will be a process. And we who are believers, we know better. That's why it says, meditate in God's word day and night, that you'll observe to do, that you will see to do, that you will see to do all that is in it. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, and you will have what? Good success. But you have to see it. You have to meditate. It takes day and night, keeping it before you, because if not, other things will want to displace that picture in you. Other people, other things, the environment will want to give you a different picture of who God really ordained you to be. And I declare in Jesus' name, the image you have in you will match what God has ordained for you in the name of Jesus. So get ready for the miraculous. Get ready for what you want, but you have to see it every day. That's why it says write the vision. Make it plain that it may run that reads it. So read it. Look at it every day. Look at the word of God. Look at what you have written. Look at the picture of your future. Look at the new you. You've got to look at it. Not just forgetting about it, but looking at it continually. Because our mind is a place of transformation. That's where we see. You will see well in Jesus' name. Romans 12:2 said, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. I want us to look at the story here, the story of the woman with the issue of blood. In fact, we have labeled her with that situation. We don't know her name, the woman with the issue of blood. Well, why can't she become the woman of the miraculous, or the healed woman? We're so used to it, the woman with the issue of blood. The issue has ended since she has been healed. But we still call her the woman with the issue of blood. And that's in Matthew chapter 9, verses 20 to 22. I'm telling you, God is awesome. God is an awesome God. I have so many testimonies in this regard. So I said I was trusting God for the fruit of the womb. It wasn't a very long waiting period, so I won't tell you how long it was, because you think that, is that waiting? But I got, somewhere along the line, I got a revelation, because I remember that, you want me to be very honest with you? So that time, we were in another ministry, we had not yet started this time. So my husband used to travel a lot because the headquarters of the ministry was in a place called Ilorin. Do you know Ilorin? Nigeria. It's towards the north. We're in Lagos right now, okay? So some of our viewers who don't really know much about Nigeria, so. And he went Lagos and he was pastoring the branch, but the headquarters were Ilorin, so he used to travel a lot for meetings, pastors' meetings, all the branch pastors. They go a lot. And so I came to a point that I felt like, when it is the time for ovulation? Do you know ovulation? Maybe it shouldn't be only the women that know ovulation. Men should know it too. How many men know ovulation? How many men don't know what ovulation is? Be honest tonight. How many men don't know what ovulation is? Okay. And they taught you in school in biology, but you are not paying attention because it didn't have to do with your body. Look at you. You're supposed to know, because when you understand, you will understand your wife, you will understand your sister, you will understand what they're going through, their period and all that. Thank God I'm not a woman. You will have compassion and you'll be able to help out. Hello? I know the men that are doctors, they know. So, anyway, I won't tell you what, because it will take out of my time with the message. Go and read it up. Is that time that when you are in ovulation, then if the sperm meets the egg, because during ovulation you are releasing egg, then you are supposed to get pregnant if the egg and the sperm are healthy. Okay? So I now timed it, because you are believing God for the fruit of the womb, right? And so you'll be calculating it. Some people, they are believing God for the fruit of the womb, they're not talking. They fight, eh? So once in 3 months, that's when they have sex. And they're believing God for fruit of the womb. Hello? What are they supposed to do? Everything. Please let me preach my message, I beg. No, it's not every day. But during the cycle, go. But you know what happens? Maybe they do every day. But during the cycle, the enemy will make them fight. So they keep missing that window of space where it's supposed to happen. And they say, we do every month, almost every day. But when you look back, there's a period, you fight, you're not talking. They're not touching each other, nothing. And it's the time that the thing is supposed to be. So woman, know yourself. Even if your man doesn't know ovulation, know yourself. When the fight wants to rise up, you say no. We are friends. My husband, sorry. It's not this time I will pick a fight with you. Let me tell you, this devil, he comes in subtle ways. I've seen it over and over and over. I know I've been called to preach for a long time, when my kids were very young. Especially my eldest. I was supposed to go somewhere, maybe even for a conference. Or to go and speak, or even just to attend a conference. We're running temperature in the morning. There are times I just say, this temperature, whether it comes out or not, I'm going. Because it becomes a pattern. Because the enemy wants to break your focus from making that connection. And that's why he tries to discourage us too from reading the word. Maybe you've told yourself, I wake up 5 a.m. every morning, 30 minutes in the word of God. I will meditate and envision what I am, what I'm meant to be. I will speak over my life and I will keep that picture in my mind and go to work. But alas, you wake up at 7 o'clock and you have to resume at 8. Will you start praying? No! You skip the prayer. I'm not saying don't pray. But the thing is, between that and losing your job, God will say, just go. Because when you lose your job now, you now come and be crying to me. Just go without prayer. Be praying as you go. I allow you for today. You are not doing God a favor. You are doing yourself a favor. Because every day you do it, you reinforce. Whatever time you have chosen, it doesn't have to be early in the morning. It could be in the evening. But you create time to envision, to meditate, to look, to see yourself as you should be. Praise God. Amen. To see yourself as you should be. Praise God. Envisioning, seeing. And so I was telling you the testimony. And so I had that mindset that, why is it so I would want to get offended? Hello? Okay, this is real Nike now, right? Nike DM me, this real woman now. Can you take it? So I would, you know, get offended because I would feel that, why is it? And you say, oh, yeah, I don't know. Is it the, I was like, why is it? So, but I now soon realized that getting offended will delay your blessing. It will delay your miracle. But you know, one day sincerely, I got into the word and I know that I like to study and read God's word. One day I got into the word, you know, and I told my husband I was no longer angry with him, whether we pray about it or you travel when we are supposed to meet or whatever. Hello? I said, if Virgin Mary could take him, I will take him. I released him from being responsible. Amen. I'm not saying that you should tell your husband, I don't need you. Because he will say, who do you want to go and sleep with? Because Virgin Mary, God did that one. He didn't say he would do any other person's on it. I'm just trying to say that was where revelation came into my heart. That it was no longer about him, timing, we calculate, you go when we are supposed to do that. It was just, Lord, this is about me and you. And it happened. Praise God. It happened. And when it happened, I didn't know it had happened. This particular day, I mean, this is like, what are we talking about? 23 years ago or so. This particular day, I went to Ibadan to visit my parents. I think it was a Monday or so. It was a weekday anyway. I went to visit my parents just to check on them briefly. Ibadan is a city in Nigeria. It's just 1 hour without the way the expressway is, the road. It's supposed to be then 1 hour from Lagos. So it's a quick trip, day trip. Just went to check on them. And we didn't, as of that time, because it wasn't a long wait, you know, we hadn't seen any doctor, been overly concerned, something was wrong. But my dad said, why don't we go and see his friend who is a renowned gynecologist. I went to school with his children as well in University of Ibadan. So he asked us to go by the place, you know, and we went to see the man. And, you know, he said, he tested me and everything, and he said, you have fibroids. He said, your womb is big, feels big, but you are not pregnant. And I knew, I didn't know I had taken it, but I knew, yeah, I was not pregnant. We are trying, and it has not happened. So, yeah, you're a gynecologist. So
he did, I think he did a urine test, whatever, just basic whatever, and then he did all the examinations, you know, and he said, the womb feels big, feels bulky, that's what he said, and you're not pregnant, so you have fibroids. I remember that I just said, I reject it in Jesus' name. The man got angry because he was not a believer. I hope he was before he passed on, but he said, do you want to tell me my job? You want to teach me? I've been doing this for... He brought out samples of fibroids that had been encased or embalmed or whatever that they had removed from people's bodies. So I now said, okay, sir, yes, sir. I now calmed down. I said, ah, what causes it? So he now, he said, these days, even in people as young as 20, you find fibroid. You know, he was now educating me on what... it was not... That's not what I wanted to hear. So he said, we're going to do an x-ray. Their x-ray machine did not work. The x... No, it wasn't the x-ray machine that didn't work. There was no power. And their generator did not work. There was no power. In those days, it was NEPA. And the generator did not work. And the power did not. And he said they should send someone to NEPA and all that. That sometimes we have a pact with them when we want to carry out a surgery. Anyway, he gave us his card. And he said, sorry, I understand your dad said you're in Lagos. But anytime you come to Ibadan again, just let me know. Just give me a call and we'll set up something. Took his card and we left. On the way, I was a bit sad. On the way back to Lagos, I was sad. I wasn't sad when we were coming to Ibadan because we just came to visit my parents. We didn't plan for this, but what I heard made me sad. Do you understand? I was trying to throw doubt in my mind that I had fibroid instead of a child. And I tell you, you know what? God has given me a revelation because eventually it happened. If they tell you that you have fibroid, I'll tell you fibroid is not the fruit of the womb. And it's one of the areas where God uses me to pray for people. Praise God. I'm not saying don't go for the surgery. Fibroid, yes, it should be taken out. It should dry up or move aside. If you need to do surgery, do surgery. But fibroid is not the fruit of the womb. It is fake. It grows in the bodies of women. It grows in the womb as if a baby is growing. It is not the fruit of the womb. If you have been told that you have fibroid, begin to envision your child in your womb. Praise God. And so, it wasn't quite 2 weeks after, I think maybe even quite about 10 days or something. I still had not seen my period. Just an irregular period. Sometimes you don't even... Anyway, I went to do a test up the street from our house then. We used to live in... Do you want to know where we live then? Barigan. The name of that street was terrible. Akpeleyin Street. You will not Akpeleyin in Jesus' name. That means interpretation. The one that is behind. And it's from that three-bedroom flat that we prayed, did communion, prayed for 30 days, did communion, and then inaugurated Daystar on Allen. It was from that same house. If the street is Akpeleyin, my house is not Akpeleyin. It is an anointed house, anointed flat. In fact, the street is anointed. So up the road, one hospital called Arjolad. People that live in Lagos, then, yeah, that's where we lived. I just went for tests casually because I said, I didn't see my... Let me just go and test. Lo and behold, I was pregnant. Now, if that x-ray, if they had carried out the x-ray, it would have destroyed the fetus. Not scan. X-ray with the sewer, because when you are pregnant, if you go to the dentist or you need to, they will say, are you pregnant? Because, or they want to do whatever, X-ray of your breast or whatever. You have to tell them, because you are pregnant, it can destroy the fetus, especially if it's still an early age. And if you are, they will give you maybe this kind of heavy mask to cover it so that the X-ray does not. So what they call fibroid was my daughter, Miss Sophie, to the glory of God. That child is achieving great things for God. Praise God. He wanted to give me another vision. So tell your neighbor, fibroid is not the fruit of the womb. Because you really don't know who you are saying it to. Amen. And I know women who have had, one of our pastors, well, I won't say her name, but when we're dedicating their third child at home, third child now is now like 6 years old, on the day of the naming ceremony, you know, we're also going to come and say, Mama, you know, and the doctor said, I have fibroid. Actually, the fibroid is just to one side with all the children I've had. So the fibroid has to move to one side and make space for the children or dry up or get out of the place. To God be the glory. But you've got to see yourself.
So what I'm saying is that because I had received the revelation before, me that told my husband that, if Virgin Mary could give birth, I'll give birth. Don't worry. Anytime we see, we see. I won't fight you over the timing. And then I was now told I had fibroid. And I was crying all the way to Lagos. But it still happened. So sometimes when you doubt, it doesn't mean that nullifies the revelation you receive. But don't stay in the doubt and make the doubt. Because some people, when they doubt, they feel that's the end. I have to start all over again. Praise God. So if I had revelation, then why did I feel sad? It was a temporary thing. Praise God. It was a temporary thing. Bad news is not good news. If you hear bad news, it makes your heart sad. But very quickly, bring on the good news. Bring on the good news. Look for the pictures again. You tell yourself, I'm a mother. It's not fiber. This womb, I will carry my children. Praise God. I'm a father of nations. Say that to yourself. And, you know, just keep speaking the word. So this woman, and so many testimonies like that, things we could not afford, but we will see and envision in our minds. Matthew chapter 9, verse 20 to 22. Matthew chapter 9, verse 20 to 22. And suddenly a woman who had a flow of blood for 12 years came from behind and touched the hem of his garment. Jesus, we know, was healing, he was preaching, he was doing good, he was blessing people just all around. She touched the hem of his garment, for she said to herself, if only I may touch his garment, I shall be made well. But Jesus turned around, and when he saw her, he said, be of good cheer, daughter, your faith has made you well. And the woman was made well from that hour. We know the story because at first his disciples, he said, who touched me? And his disciples were saying, there are many people, but there was a touch. It was a touch of faith. Someone made a demand on him. Someone made a pull on him. Make a demand on God's word. You have the Holy Spirit in your heart and you have the word of God. Make a demand on the word of God. Envision. She must have envisioned herself that if I can touch his garment, I will be made well. And she was made well. And there are many people that touched him that day. We don't know if they got their miracle. That's faith. That's faith. She saw it in her heart. She saw that picture. Of course, she had tried so many things, so many doctors. It didn't work. So, with everything that you may have tried, try Jesus. Try plugging into him. Try plugging into his word and making a demand on his word and envisioning. Prayer opens our inner eyes. It causes us to see. Jeremiah chapter 33 verse 3 says, call to me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you do not know. Jeremiah 33 verse 3. Call unto me and I will what? Answer you and show you great and mighty things that you do not know. It's powerful. Then we call on God. He shows us. And then we pray with the word he has shown us. He prays. We pray with the picture he has shown us. We pray with revelation and we wait for the manifestation. That you have been shown something doesn't mean that the next day it will happen. But you hold on. You keep the picture in your mind. The picture David Joseph had was there. It took a long time. In fact, it's like his destiny went in the reverse direction before it came to pass, but it still came to pass. So don't give up. Don't be discouraged. Whatever it is, you will build that business. You will own that territory. Whatever it is God has shown you, you will be a person of influence. Start where you are, but keep that picture. Keep that picture in your heart. God said to me, he said, you're a mother of mothers. And I had not had a child that time. I was praying to God. He said, you're a mother of mothers. And it has come to pass now. Praise God. God can show you something. When God told me that, he said, you're a mother of mothers. I was asking God for the fruit of the womb. And he said, you're a mother of mothers. And he was not talking about the fruit of the womb. He was talking about my destiny. Sometimes you ask God to show you something. He's showing you something else. But within what is showing you is the answer to what you are asking for.
So if he said, you're a mother of mothers, women older than you will come lean on you for encouragement, for the word, and you know, etc., like that. And I didn't look like it at that time, because I think this was still within a few months of our marriage. I did not look like it. But today is history. So I could use that word as well, that if I'm a mother of mothers, then that means I will have my own child, because I'll be someone that other mothers too will come and say, ah, how did you do it? How did you raise your children? Praise God. I see God doing great things through you.
Amen.
Not just for you, but through you.
Amen.
Say, God, use me. Let your blessings pass through me to change people's lives. And I'm telling you, the more you see yourself that way, the more it will come to pass. Because God will say, yes, indeed, this one has made himself available to me. Praise God. You know, Satan fights our dream, and I said that earlier on, Mark chapter 4:14. He said that these are the words that were sown by the wayside, where the word of God is sown. He says, when they hear, Satan comes and takes away the word that is sown in their hearts. Mark chapter 4, verse 14. The word of God is sown in your heart, but the enemy comes to try and steal it away, to try and confuse you on what you have seen and what you know. And that's what he did for Eve. He said, has God said? Did God say, actually, that's not the way he said it? You've got to know what you believe. I said, get thee behind me, Satan. No matter how long it takes, I know that I'm going to be happily married. No matter how long it takes, I know that I'm going to run that business. No matter how long it takes, I'm not going to own a house, but I'm going to provide housing for people. Because I know God has called me to real estate business. You've got to say it, you've got to declare it. And then you realize that this one is saying something. She can't be confused. He can't be confused. Praise God. So see through to breakthrough. See through. So many instances. See through. Jesus said in Luke chapter 4, verse 4, he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. That word shapes our mind. It shapes our mind. God said, let's make man in our image. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. One of the scriptures I love so much. Then God said, Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the bird of the air, and over everything that creeps, you know, on the earth. And verse 27 says, and so God created man, what? In his image. He didn't just say it, but he did it. He said to the Godhead, he said, let's make man. And he created man in the image of God. He created him, male and what?
Female.
Thank God we are all included. Hello? Who's not a male or female here? So, I know some people are confused about their identity. And honestly, it's not funny, because our hearts go out to them. Some people are not sure. Not only in this part of the world, but in other parts of the world, but we see it happening also in Nigeria. So it's not a, you know, because many times we Nigerians, we jump, say, Oyinbo, whatever. We need to have compassion on these people. The way I see it is that you're born a female, but you think you're a male. All the genitals, whatever, prove it. But they think they are. So there's confusion. It's a sad thing, because it's the devil's work. Do you agree with me?
Yes.
It's the devil's work. I don't think they just woke up and decided to defy God. But it confused their mentality, their thinking, and then begin to think, even though I look like male, but I'm feeling like a female. So I will change to female. Then you have transgender, they do surgery, they do, you know, all kinds of things. It's really sad, because we have received the mercy of God that you know that you are a woman and you are actually manifesting as a woman. Some of these people are really, really confused. And it's the work of the devil. It's the work of the devil. He tampered with something in their mind. Some when they were small, some when they had grown up through wrong association. But they were convinced otherwise. And then they'll be doing it underground, doing it, and then you now hear them say, I'm going to come out. I'm going to come out. There's no more hiding. And then at that point in time, their fellow people really, you know, applaud them for their courage. And indeed, it's courageous in their circles because it's not the norm to be hiding something and then come out and say, and everybody, ah. But the issue is that that's why we need to pray for people. We need to pray for our world. It's a confusion of the highest order. Not here to defend them or defend anyone, but truly, many of them feel, I feel like a woman, my voice is like a woman, but my body is, I'm going to cut off this thing and go be. Don't laugh. Some of them go through so much pain to have surgery to adjust the body to fit how they are feeling. It's an identity crisis of the highest order. It's very sad. I pray that anyone that is confused about their gender or their identity, that there will be healing in Jesus' name. There will be healing in the name of Jesus. I'm more concerned for them than about my kids, or because some people say, these are people that go to school with our children. They will corrupt them. And then why? You need to feel sorry for them and feel broken that the devil is treating them this way. If you raise your child well with the word of God, there's no need to be afraid. You get, even if you send your child abroad, I'm saying it's not only in other Western nations that is happening. It's happening here. It happens in boarding schools in this very Nigeria, even in my time. You hear of lesbianism, gay, you know, and all of that. So it's been a progressive thing. So that in our own environment, there's been our culture, you know, we cover things up a lot. But now with the advent of social media and all of that, people don't care anymore. So it's not about that. It's about what you have put in your child. The word of God that you've put in your child. The identity you have given your child. Praise God. You tell your child who your child is from the word of God and you keep encouraging. So why should the child now be confused after? Hello? But sometimes, you know, there isn't enough rootedness to be rooted in God's word and to be rooted in love. And that's why as parents or custodians of young people, we need to be there for them. Praise God. Time will fail me to talk about the story of how a man who is someone known to us, you know, confided in my husband that he was he became gay. How he became gay. I'm not saying all gay people become gay that way, but he said that. Today he's straight, but he said many times, you know, I still need my wife because he's married with children, thank God. I still need my wife to help me to be accountable. When I heard that story, I saw that, this thing is not just all of them that just want to be that way. Said when he was young that maybe he was like age 5, then he had a cousin who was 7 years old, something like that. So his mom used to had him, not her husband, I think she was a single mom, but there was a man friend, male friend she had that used to come to their house and they didn't have much. So he and his mom, I think they shared a room, or just a room and parlor, a very small house. And so he'll be outside and this woman will be having sex with her man friend or boyfriend. And he said his cousin and himself, it was his cousin that started it. He said, come. And they'll be looking through the keyhole and they'll be seeing all the action. Then his cousin, who was older than him, maybe 7 or 8 by a few years, said, let's practice. They will now be practicing it on themselves. 2 boys. He said, until that his cousin went to boarding house, went to school, then they stopped. Somewhere along the line, that feeling resurrected. And he said he found himself as an adult longing for men. And so he said, sometimes he still struggles. This was years ago, that sometimes he still struggles, but his wife helps him to be accountable. She knows sometimes when she's looking like, he said, that boy, no, he will not follow us today. I just want him to come to the house. He will not come to the house because you are already liking him. Can you imagine? That's strange. That's what a woman could say to her husband, Abby, that girl, no, she will not follow us. And he shared this. That gave me insight into he did not want to be that way. But parental neglect caused it. It was sown in his life. So he will tell you that gay, they are not born gay. Something happened. He said, I was in it and I was not born that way. But I knew when that spirit, you know, when it happened. Because he and his cousin brother were sleeping with each other innocently, trying to practice what they were saying a man and woman. They were not supposed to see that. Let's move very quickly. God will use us to heal the world.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. So Genesis 1, 26 to 28. So what I see there is that he said, let's make man in according to our likeness and let them have dominion over us. Let's make man in our image. And I like to say, no image, no dominion. He said, let's make man in our image and let them have dominion over the earth. And so he made male and female in the image of. So when you lose that image of God in you, then you lose dominion. And to be made, and that's why I said this year, I said, I'm made in the image of God. And if we are made in the image of God, we are creative, we think big, we have ideas, we're in partnership with God. We are made, he said, and in the image of God. So keep that image so that you may have dominion. Keep that image. The animals are not made in the image of God, so we have dominion over them. But we are made. So if anything this year, be particular about what you are seeing. Be particular about the image that is in you. If you can see through, then you will have a breakthrough.